You guys about ready to go?
Line number one, you're supposed to have it all together. And when they ask how you're doing, just smile, tell them never better. To everybody's life is perfect except yours. So keep your messes and your wounds and your secrets safe with you behind closed doors. Truth be told, the truth is rarely told. I say I'm fine, yeah I'm fine, oh I'm fine, hey I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken.
What a wonderful way to start the service. Thank you to the Jammers for that lovely and meaningful piece of music. Welcome, welcome, welcome here to Quispamsis United Church on a day that is damp and wet outside, but that is warm and dry and welcoming inside. Whether you are here in the sanctuary or worshiping with us online, whether you are here because you come every week, or whether you are here for the first or second time, please know that you are welcome in this place and that God's gifts of hope and peace and joy and love are offered to you. Here at Quispamsis United Church, we profess to be a community that strives to be open and welcoming and accepting of all people. And the words in the opening piece of music, truth be told, that the Jammers did, talk about how the Spirit of God welcomes those who are sick and those who have sinned and those who see themselves to be prodigals, those who are broken. The truth is that regardless of who you are, regardless of what you have done, regardless of what you have not done, you are worthy, you are welcome, and God's gifts of hope and grace and love are offered to you and to you this day.
As part of our welcome, we light this candle, lit from the flame of Christ's own light and love, as we proclaim ourselves a community where all people are invited without barriers based on age, gender, race, sexual orientation, gender identity and expression, differing abilities, ethnic background, or economic circumstance. We celebrate the richness that diversity brings to our church, even as it challenges us to walk down roads we have not yet traveled. We pray for God's Spirit to guide us as we work for reconciliation and justice for all persons in both church and society. As we gather to worship, let us pause to remember that in this region, we live and work and worship on lands that are, by law, the unceded territories of the Wabanaki peoples, predominantly the lands of the Mi'kmaq, Wolastoqiyi, Passamaquoddy, and Penobscot. May we live with respect on this land and live in peace and friendship with its people.
Thank you, Heather. As a community of faith, we gather to support one another in times that can be challenging, but we also gather to celebrate with one another when special occasions occur. Are there any celebrations to acknowledge Sally's granddaughter? Yay! Congratulations, Sally. I hope everyone is well. That's wonderful. Other celebrations. Jesse's birthday today. Happy birthday, Jesse. Many, many happy returns. Hope this is a great day for you. Other celebrations. Turn five this week. Yay.
And it was a great birthday.
Yeah, and it was a great birthday. That's even better. Some of us get to the age where every birthday that comes can be seen to be a great birthday, but it's especially good when it happens to a five-year-old. Other celebrations. Let's join in the singing of our opening music, our choral intro. Please join me in our call to worship. We gather as a community of friends who yearn to know God as revealed through the Word and the way of Jesus.
We gather as people in need of mercy, grace, and love.
We gather to discern God's will and assist one another in following God's way.
We gather to reorder our priorities, refocus our lives, and to ask God's help in finding new life.
Let us pray together. Gracious and loving God, throughout the ages you have sent prophets and teachers to help your people reorient their lives and embrace the wisdom and guidance you have given. Help us hear and heed your direction today, so we might more fully embrace your counsel, embody your grace, and follow your way. Amen. Our opening hymn is from More Voices, number 30. It's a song of praise to our Maker. I'm taking a real risk this morning as a preacher by handing out stones, because one never quite knows what someone is going to do with those stones, especially when you hear what today's scripture reading is all about. But with that in mind, anybody didn't get a stone when they came in? Did you get one? You got one? Ruth didn't get one. Well, there you go, Ruth. Gotta have a rock. One, two, here we go. Yeah. Here we go. Do I have little ones? Why don't you share those? Anybody else? Here you go. No, I still got some. One, two. There we go. Just enough. And if you don't have one, you can share. So, that's right. So during this season of Lent, rather than having a formal prayer of confession, what we've decided to do is to have a time of personal contemplation. And What I'd like us to reflect on this morning in our own way is the question of priorities. All of us have lots of choices to make. We have lots of options that are before us. Some of us have demands made upon us or responsibilities that we need to attend to. But in other aspects of life, there are things we can choose to focus on and pay attention to and give priority to and orient our lives around. And there are aspects of life that we can decide maybe do not deserve the attention that we may have given them in the past. So this morning, I would invite you to take a couple of minutes in silence, maybe sit back and take a deep breath and think about priorities. Think about what is most important to you right now. And if there is a shift in priorities that you may feel it would be good to make. May God guide us and bless us in our discerning. Amen. Would you like to come up to the front for a couple of minutes? Would you be willing to do that? Maybe your grandma would bring you up? Yeah? No? You want to stay where you are? No, you're going to come up. Come on up. I got something I need your help with. I have a friend I want to introduce you to. This is my friend Rabbit. And I've had Rabbit for a long time. But do you know what I've never done? I've never given Rabbit a real name. See, I just call him Rabbit, and that would be like me just calling you Boy. Yeah. And that wouldn't be very good, would it? No. So, Rabbit said to me, you know, it's about time you gave me a real name. And when I was thinking about priorities, I thought, you know, I got to give Rabbit a real name. But I'm not always very good at names, so can you help me think of a name that we could get? Jordan? Yeah, Jordan's a pretty good. Carter. Now, why do you think I should call him Carter? So Jordan and Carter. Any other names?
Bob.
Bob? Yeah. So maybe we should do a vote. Do you think we should do a vote? What do we have? Jordan, Carter, and Bob. Anybody else? So who votes for Jordan? This is Rabbit. Who votes for Jordan? Come on. Carter. Bob. Bob it is. Hello, Bob.
Yeah.
Do you like that name? You do? Well, there you go, Bob. So, bye. So sometimes we need help in doing things that we know we should have done a long time ago. and finally get around to. So thank you guys, thank you, the two of you for coming, the three of you for coming up. And if you want, now you can go to Sunday school with Una. Yay! And anybody else can go too if they want.
To 22. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years. And you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
A candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who rings a fire, ignites a candle. Darkness, seek out the helpless. hearts are blazing. So let's raise our candles and light up the sky.
Once again, that was lovely. Thank you. Let's pray. Holy One, may the words spoken, heard, and pondered be acceptable in your sight, be in accordance with your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Imagine for a moment that you showed up at this church on a Sunday morning, kind of like this, though maybe not quite so rainy. You would enter as you would normally do. You would receive a warm welcome from one of the greeters back or down at the lower foyer. And then you would approach these sanctuary doors as usual. That's what we do in one form or another every week. But on this particular Sunday, you arrive and you find a cluster of shocked-looking people standing outside these closed sanctuary doors. There's noise and shouting inside, so one of you opens the door just a bit. And what does that person see? There are some hymnals flying through the air. The big maroon-colored Voices United ones that can hurt if they land. Then you see this communion table being overturned. Those candles go tumbling down. And then you see the back of someone heading off towards the organ in the rear corner. What on earth is going on in there, you wonder aloud. Has Reverend Ian totally lost it? Some other lunatic in there? What is going on? Then one of you, some very brave soul, actually ventures into the sanctuary at the back, has a look around, and then comes right back out. Someone who looks an awful lot like Jesus is in there, you would say. And wow, is he ever mad. Hard to imagine Isn't it something like that happening in a place like this? But if you think about it, this is pretty much the scene that is described in John's gospel. We read that Jesus entered the temple, a place where folks were doing what they would normally do during Passover, but then saw the vendors selling their cattle and their sheep and their doves. Then he made a whip and kicked over the tables and destroyed the bird cages, set the cattle free, dumped the cash drawers onto the floor. Chaos ensued, like the chaos we imagined happening here. And then, as now, the people of that place 2,000 years ago saw the order and the sacredness of that space be totally upended and were left completely shocked and aghast. No wonder that the temple officials became angry and irate with Jesus, is it? I don't know about you, but if that was to happen here, I would be feeling pretty irate, upset. Back then, the practices that Jesus was criticizing had long been sanctioned by Hebrew scripture. There was nothing inherently wrong with what was happening because this was part of the way that the Jewish community in the first century Palestine celebrated Passover. For centuries, faithful Jews had been sacrificing doves and sheep and cattle during this holy season. It was their way of honoring God. It was a cherished rite. Yes, the rich bought oxen to sacrifice. The middle class bought sheep, and the poorer people could only afford doves. So social divisions were reinforced. And yes, some of the merchants who exchanged secular money for temple money that was needed to buy these sacrifices were pretty crooked. But the basic ritual was intact. The faithful took their sacrifice to the priest up at the altar and in return received a blessing in God's name. And doing so was important. But not, it seems, for Jesus. He believed that the religious authorities had corrupted this sacred ritual in a host of unacceptable ways. In particular, he saw that the temple had become an emporium or a marketplace rather than a place of worship, and that its leaders had given precedence to wealth rather than prayer. Indeed, Passover had become a time for the temple authorities to milk as much money out of the common people as possible, so that they could look after themselves and pay off the Roman authorities to whom they were beholden. No longer was it an occasion to draw the faithful closer to God, or to use those funds that were collected to help those in the community whose needs were acute. So Passover's true meaning had been lost. And that's why Jesus, the rebel in this case, followed the example of the Old Testament prophets by challenging what was going on and by calling for a new focus on God and on God's statutes. That's what was going on in the temple that day, and it can be kind of hard to get our heads around. can't it? Because this is not the gentle Jesus, meek and mild, that we learned about in Sunday school, is it? Nor is it the Jesus who welcomed little children, who offered soothing words and a healing hand to the blind and the lame. Instead, this is a passionate Jesus who challenged certain practices and norms that he believed were wrong and even blasphemous. Indeed, he seemed to think so little of what was going on in the temple that day that he said he could come back and tear the whole thing down in 3 days. So, what do we make of this account and of this particular side of Jesus? Well, I believe that through his actions, Jesus is posing some fundamental questions about priorities. In particular, the priorities that the temple's religious leaders had come to hold. And that he's challenging them to stop what they're doing and refocus their priorities on matters that are more foundational to the gospel. And John's gospel points to a couple of those more foundational elements of the faith in the two stories that come just before and just after this reading. Immediately prior to this, Jesus attended a wedding feast where he responded to the requests of his mother to help the hosts out of a sticky celebration and help the celebration continue by turning water into wine. Then, right after leaving the temple, Jesus engages Nicodemus, the Pharisee, in a serious conversation about the faith, so that Nicodemus will more fully understand what Jesus is about and the work that needs to be done. So Jesus seems to be intent on bringing joy and relief to those who are in distress and to helping people celebrate the special moments of life. And he's also keen to help others understand and know the way that he reveals. And he's absolutely passionate about ending exploitive religious and social practices like those that were going on in the temple that kept people from knowing that they are truly loved by God. Those seem to be at least some of Jesus' priorities. These are the elements of faith that he had passion for. And that's part of what drove him to dismantle what was going on in the temple so that something new and more faithful, more life-giving and just could emerge. So if that's the case, then perhaps this story can encourage us to embrace some of Jesus' priorities a little bit more, to make it a priority to enjoy and cherish life's special moments and to help others do the same, to assure us that it is natural to have questions and doubts, and that it can be faithful to raise them, to explore them, and to question. And it can remind us that entrenched injustices and destructive patterns can sometimes only be overthrown when people have the courage and the passion to challenge them. And perhaps it's calling religious communities like ours to take a serious look at our collective priorities and do what's necessary to align them more fully with Jesus' way. Of course, tasks like this can be daunting. We all know it can be easier and safer to stick with the status quo rather than risk disruption. It can be easier to shrug our shoulders and say, well, that's the way things are and there's nothing we can do, than to draw attention to problems and to try to seek solutions. And it can be much easier to keep our mouths shut and go quietly along than to take actions that can generate controversy and cause discord. Jesus, I think, understood that. And he knew full well what the consequences may well be for him to go into that temple and do what he did that day. But still, that's what he did. And over the decades, faithful people in denominations like the United Church of Canada have been filled with other passionate people who have courageously followed in Jesus' footsteps by encouraging church and society to embrace some different priorities and commit themselves to installing some new patterns. I think of the leaders of the church union movement in the 1920s, who cared deeply for their people, who desperately wanted their congregations to grow rather than to decline, to be filled with new joy and passion, and who believed that bringing some of Canada's churches together could foster new ideas and energies and initiatives. I think of those in the 20s and the 30s who believed that women should have the right to be ordained, who spent years explaining why doing so was consistent with the foundational tenets of the gospel, and who decided in 1936 to ordain the Reverend Lydia Grucci and begin a new tradition of ordaining and empowering women. I think of those who supported former Baptist preacher turned Premier Tommy Douglas of Saskatchewan in striving for a publicly funded healthcare system, because they had seen and had too many of their loved ones suffer and die because there wasn't enough money available to see a doctor, and who refused to rest until this injustice had been rectified. In more recent times, I think of those who in the 1980s courageously led the study of human sexuality in ministry, and who in 1988 supported the General Council resolution declaring that all persons, regardless of orientation, who profess their faith in Jesus Christ are welcome to become members of the United Church of Canada, and that all members of the United Church of Canada are eligible to be considered for ordered ministry. And I think of those of you here at Quispamsis United Church who have explored over the last few years what it means to be an affirming church, who studied and talked and prayed and discerned, and who ultimately decided to take this important, this spirit-filled steps. Reforms, changes like these are far from easy. And as some of you know pretty well, making changes like these can result in some strong opposition arising from those who disagree and who prefer the status quo. But the impulse to stay true to Jesus and to follow Jesus' lead has prevailed time and time and time again in the church. It has led us to act in ways that draw on our best instincts and that set us apart and make us unique. So as we here at Quispamsis United get ready to consider a report from the Faith Profile Committee after worship next Sunday, may we keep working and commit ourselves to the task of continuing to align our priorities as best we can with the foundational tenets and beliefs of Jesus. And as we do this, I am absolutely confident that the Spirit that has been present in this church for so long will be unleashed in new ways and will be invited to lead us on new and faith-filled paths. May it be so. Amen. Very warm welcome once again to all of you here in the sanctuary and online. It is wonderful to be together. Those of us in the sanctuary are invited to adjourn downstairs for some coffee and some refreshments, and very much hope that you will be able to do that. The life and work of this church continues in some important ways during this Lenten season, as was noted in the announcements that Leslie set out on Thursday, there will be two adult study sessions this week. One will be a Zoom discussion on Monday at 7 o'clock, looking at one of Kate Bowler's books. And on Tuesday morning, we will be engaged in our second of five studies of some of the major world religions, and this time we will be looking at Buddhism. These sessions stand alone, and so don't feel that you can't come if you missed the first one. Reminder as well about the important Affirming Churches event coming up at Harmony United Church on March the 16th that we here at Quispamsis are co-sponsoring with Harmony and the good folks at Westfield. Speaker from Chrome, New Brunswick will be there to continue to educate us and make us more sensitive and aware of some of the issues facing some in our community who are most marginal. And our invitation as a congregation is to bring pies to this event because the following day on the 17th is what the United Church deems Pie Sunday, public, intentional, and educational. So please mark that day in your calendar and plan to attend. I believe Bob Crowley has an announcement.
Just a reminder, as Reverend Ian has already mentioned, congregational meeting next Sunday to review the faith profile report. We're that close to having it done. So it will be emailed out to from the church office to everybody Wednesday, Thursday of this week. If you do need a hard copy or don't have access to regular email, please contact the church office or give me a call or send me a note or anybody in the Faith Profile Committee. If able, I'd ask, we will be on Zoom, as we always are for our congregational meetings, but I would ask, because of the nature of the information and some possible discussion, if you're able to be in the sanctuary, that certainly simplifies that. So for those able to be here, please do so, and if not, we will still be there for you on Zoom. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob, and thank you for all of your hard work and the work of your committee. Other announcements? Pieces of news. The life and work of the church relies on the efforts of all of us. The generous giving of time and energy and talent and money. We are grateful for these gifts. We give God thanks for the spirit that has resulted in such generosity. And we offer our thanks through the dedication hymn. God, the source of all good things, we bring to you our gifts, our earthly things, the love of our hearts, and the service of our lives. All this we give through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Once again, the Jammers.
a dream has died. Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire. Just to know you and to make you known, we lift your name on high. Shine like the sun, make darkness run and hide. We know we were made for so much more than ordinary lives. It's time for us to more than just survive. Show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire. Just to know
Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks this day for your gifts of living water, for the assurance you offer that we are made for so much more than simply living ordinary lives, and that through your Spirit we are enabled to thrive so that joy and faith and love will fill our hearts and be shared with all we meet. For these gifts of hope and life and faith, we give you thanks. We're also grateful, O God, for the wisdom and the guidance that you reveal to us through your prophets, through your saints, past and present, through the ancestors of our faith, and ultimately through the word and the way of Jesus. Be with us in these days to come to remind us of the priorities by which you would have us adhere. The way that you would have us be, the path you would have us take. This morning, O God, we remember those who are finding these days to be difficult, who are struggling with questions and issues and challenges, and who aren't sure which way to turn. We remember for those worrying about making ends meet, for those like those who have lost their jobs, for those who are facing unexpected and unwanted challenges, and for all who are concerned about the way the world is going. Grant us peace and hope and strength as we go forth. We pray, O God, for this congregation and for all churches that are searching for new ways to witness and be in a changing culture. Keep us strong in faith. Reveal your guiding presence to us and make us creative agencies of healing and hope in our communities. We pray for our nation and for all the nations of the world and ask that leaders with courage and wisdom and compassion to confront the challenges of these times would emerge, and that they would do so with the Spirit of Jesus in mind. Guide citizens to discern the difference between conspiracy theories and truth telling, and help us find our way. We pray for innocent victims of violence around the world in Gaza and Ukraine and Sudan and so many other troubled places. Work through advocates for peace and justice to bring an end to conflict, to inspire change where it is needed, and to offer daily bread to those whose lives and livelihoods have been disrupted. And finally, O God, we pray for all those who are enduring pain and illness, who are facing grief and loss, and for those who work to relieve suffering and respond to cries for help. We pray this morning for Keith, for Mac and family, for Paul and Carol and Kyle, for Jacques and Palm, for Peg, for Greg and Jace and family, for Ken and Arlene, for Kelly, for Hillary, for Heather, for Tiki, for Bob and Bonnie, for Jim, for Darren and family, for Bob and Yvette, for Peter and Pam, Leslie and Richard, Miriam and Rick. We pray for Joanne and Ron, Andrea and John, Stefan, Greg, Terry, Janet, for Wood and Joan, for Pat, for Vanine, for Tracy, for Dale, for Maribeth, for Wayne, for Stephen, for Lindy, for Lois, and for those whose names we lift before you now. Grant rest and renewal to all who find their situations challenging and exhausting, O God. Be our and their comfort and encouragement day by day. We offer these and all of our prayers as we lift our voices together in the following way. Our closing hymn is number 686.
Thank you.
special thanks this morning to the Jammers for their amazing gifts of music. We are so grateful to Stephen for his music, for our great tech team up there, for Leslie doing the bulletins and everything else that's been going on. It's been a great morning. As we continue our journey through the season of Lent, let us remember the words of the prophet Micah. What does the Lord require of us? To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God. And as we depart from this place, may the grace of God attend you. May the love of God surround you, and may the Holy Spirit keep you this day and always. Amen.